All right. Good morning, church.
Good morning.
How are you guys doing?
Blessed.
You guys ready to worship the Lord?
Yes.
But before we get started, I just had a couple of announcements I had to make. So number one, I just want to let you guys know that if you guys could look up there at the balcony, those of you guys that can, we have a few students there. They're ready to go to camp, so we're going to be praying for, I'm asking the church for prayer for the students, and then that week we're going to have a busy week, but the following Friday, we're all taking off to San Diego. So we're going to have our network, and God has prepared something for our students. They're ready to go. So please, church, be praying for our students. Another thing I wanted to let you guys know is as soon as that comes, we're going to start fundraising for our students once again, because we want to take them to summer camp, right? And then we have the women's retreat coming up. Look, I was talking to Angelica and I'm like, man, I remember January 1st. Now we're in April, middle of April. Time just keeps going and just keeps going. It doesn't stop, right? So we have all these things and it's all for you guys. So be part of it. Be part of what we're doing in the church, because you know what? As we gather together in this, as God puts this event together, we put this event together, we're able to fellowship with each other. Amen? You're all invited to everything that we have, right? If it's students, let our students go. If it's a men's ministry, let the men's go. If it's a women's ministry, let's let the women's go, right? But let's be part of this big family that we have. Amen? Mm-hmm. I just want to tell you, also let you guys know, like, we will be having a raffle coming soon, so that's going to be for the men's ministry. It's coming up. We'll kind of announce that next week, and just to give you a heads up, all right? We're going to have, it's going to be for Mother's Day, so men, start collecting a little bit of money to get some raffle tickets. It's going to be something good, all right? So just start collecting that money. The other thing I wanted to let you guys know is I just want to... If you're new to here to the church, I just want to tell you welcome. Welcome to Neighborhood Church. Amen? All right. So, God, this morning, as I was preparing the message last night for our students, because we're going to have the students up there, and I just want to share with you guys a little bit of what God put in my heart. All right? Because I believe it has to do with worship. It has to do with worship. And it talks about... And if you guys got your Bibles, Acts chapter 16, verse 25, it says, about midnight, Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns to God. Paul was in jail, and he was worshiping. They decided at midnight to have a worship night and be praying. And when they started doing that, the prisoners were listening to them. And suddenly, there was such a violent earthquake that the foundation of the prisons were shaken. At once, all the prison doors flew open and everyone's chains came loose. Amen. Can I tell you something? When we worship God, those chains come loose. So I don't know what you're going through today, but as you're worshiping God, know that God is here. When you're worshiping God, God shows up. So as we worship God today, look, God is here. And if something's chaining you up, those chains are going to come loose. Do you believe that? Yeah. All right. So with that said, we're going to pray to get this service started. And just remember, God is here. The presence of the Lord is here. Where two or more are gathered in His name, God is there. Amen. So we're going to be ready to just worship God. And as we're doing that, like, just give it all to Him. Just focus on God. This service is all about Him. Nothing about the worship team that we have up here. Nothing about the preacher that is going to be preaching today. But it's all about God. Amen? So we could all just get up for a second. You know? Just kind of stretch out, right? And let's get ready. You guys ready? Heavenly Father, we just want to thank you, Lord, for this morning. We just want to ask you, Lord, that as we go into service, Lord, that you just take control over the service, Lord. That as our pastor comes up here and gives a word, Lord, that you're going to use him as a vessel to deliver that message. that you have for us, that we're going to be able to open our hearts, our minds, for what you have for us today, Lord. And we just want to ask you, Lord, that as we go, Lord, we make this about you. In Jesus' mighty name, and his church says, amen.
Oh, news to everyone. It's a new day, it has come. Jesus, you say, there's a time comes, the cross. Love is come to rescue us. Thank you.
Good morning, Natalie.
Good morning.
I'm here to talk to you today about our time, is about perspective. As men, we don't like have to. So don't look at your time as a have to. Look at this as get to.
Amen.
We get to. Because God gave what we have to give, God gave us. Every bit, every penny you earned, God gave you. And so what does he ask in return? 10%. Every time you make a purchase, they don't cost you 8.75% sales tax.
That's right.
Isn't God worth that extra 1.25%? What about our family here? We all like being here?
Yeah.
Look at our kids up there.
Yeah.
Yep. Do we like having this place? Do we like having heat in the winter, air conditioning in the summer?
Yes, sir.
All that comes from you. The very last book of the Old Testament, Malachi said, in the book of Malachi, it says, but you ask, how do we rob you? God said, in tithes and offerings. You are under a curse, the whole nation of you, because you are robbing me. Bring the whole tithe into the storehouse, that there may be food in my house. Test me in this, says the Lord Almighty, and see if I will not throw open the floodgates of heaven and pour out so much blessing that we do not have enough room to store it. I love being blessed.
Yeah.
I've been blessed with this church, blessed with salvation, blessed with a wife. Just the blessings have just been poured upon me. And if all he wants is my love and what I can do, 10% seems an awful small price to pay. I hope that God puts in your heart to be faithful, to be mindful, so that the floodgates can open in your house, so that those blessings will fill your storerooms, your homes. Let me go ahead and pray. Heavenly Father, we come before you humbly, and we thank you for this day. We ask that you bless everybody in here and know that we're all your faithful servants and your children. We ask that you look upon each one of our households and you put your hedge of protection around each of us. And you give us the ability to go out there and be blessed by blessing others. We all ask this in your Son Jesus' name, and we all said,
Amen.
Jesus is called.
I remember back many years ago, it was the late 70s. How many know where Roland Heights is? Is that like Hacienda Heights? Do you know where that is? Well, I used to live out there, and one day I had to go buy something. So after work, I went down and I was in a store, and I noticed that there was a guy in there, and it turns out that he was the owner of the store. So I just had this unction to talk to this guy. I told this guy, I said, you know, I want you to remember, this is after we talked for a minute, said, I want you to remember a couple of things that I tell you. So there's going to be a time, and I don't know when, but there's a time in the future that there's going to be a lot of changes. And I gave him just a little bit of a breakdown of what it would look like in the future. I wasn't prophetically saying anything, but yet I was, because I was telling him what the Bible said. And that's, you know, the Bible's prophetic. How many know the Bible's prophetic? It talks about things in the future. So I was telling this guy, when you see these things start to happen, one of the things that I told him, I said, you know, you may not believe in Jesus right now, but are you open? He said, I'm open. And I said, well, remember this, when you start to see that we become a cashless society, and I just gave him a little quick snippet of what it would look like. I was thinking about that this morning as we were worshiping, because guess what, guys? Did you see it on the news? Is anybody watching what I'm watching? And you know, pretty much, I'm already used to it, and so this is just exactly how it will be. We are already used to, let me ask you this, here's a poll of the place. How many carry a lot of cash in your wallet?
No.
I mean, when somebody asks me to pay for something with cash, I don't have any cash. How many carry quarters, nickels, and pennies?
No.
Nobody. Well, they won't buy anything in the first place. So, here we are. They're talking about very soon, and it's coming from the top down. I have some friends that I talk to, doesn't matter who they are, but some of them are in banking, and we're getting ready to have all of our money. Don't worry, we're already used to it, aren't we?
Yeah.
I don't know about how you are, but all I have to do this morning, when I paid for the donuts over there, they said, you pay in cash or credit? It's like, I don't have cash. So they just have a little box right there, and all you do is just take your card, and it goes bleep. Then if you look at your statement, the money just came out of your account. So you guys were already there, so don't freak out on me. We're going cashless very quickly, and if you have one of these, you'll be able to use this. If you have a card, you'll be able to use that. You won't have to have cash anymore, because there won't be any cash. So if you got $100 in the bank, that will just be converted to digital money. Why am I telling you all this? Because I want you to know how close we are to the return of Jesus. When I told that man that was the owner of that store about all these things that were going to happen, he kind of looked at me like, right, cashless society? One world order? Like, impossible. Well, guess what, guys? It's more possible today than it ever was before. So what it tells me is that if you read the Bible and you go back thousands of years, somebody knew about this before this ever happened. They knew what's going to happen. And so they've already told us what it looks like. So whether you believe in God or not, whether you believe Jesus came, whether you believe he died on the cross, there's a lot of proof that he was here. Almost 2,000 years ago, he left us, and he said that he's coming back again. And all the things he's been putting in place for almost 2,000 years, perfectly, they're falling, maybe not to us. They're not perfect because our timing and God's timing is different. So we look at this, and many of us can start to become fearful about what's going to happen. I'm not fearful because I know that there's hope. We celebrated last Sunday that when they killed Jesus, they murdered him. All hope looked like it was gone and vanished from those 12 men that lived, ate, breathed, and slept with Jesus. You know how much time they spent with him? Over 3 years. And then to see their master, their friend, the one that they loved, to see him get murdered? But the story wasn't over. He came back to life. Jesus brought him back to life. And he's alive and well on planet Earth. And everything is working out perfectly the way that God planned it. So not for one moment do you want to ever become so busy and so caught up, and like Dr. Luke tells us in the Gospels, we have to be careful not to get caught up in all of the anxiety and everything, because he spells it out very well. He says, because there's going to be a lot of stuff going on, but in the middle of all that, it's going to come like a thief in the night. You guys know there was a movie made about it. There's going to come a time when Jesus is going to come back, and it says that no one on the whole earth will be able to escape it. It doesn't matter if you live in Ethiopia, South America, in a little village out in the middle of nowhere where there is no electronics, technology, Jesus is still going to come back. It says that he's going to take, and there's going to be a meeting in the sky, and all of the church that is the church, when he comes back, all those people that are alive are going to get snatched up, that have believed in Jesus, that have lived for Jesus, and walked with Jesus, and profess that he is Lord. I'm not ashamed. I'm not ashamed about Jesus. Are you ashamed? I'm not ashamed. And so I tell everybody I can, and there's a lot of haters. There are haters. People hated Jesus, so he told us, he said, if they hated me and you love me and you follow me, then don't expect that everybody's going to love you. So I'm so excited about the times that we're living in, and we are right on the very precipice of some very major changes. And what's going to happen is you're going to see such a change in America so rapidly and so quickly that you're going to see a lot of churches that are going to be filled up quickly. How many remember 9/11? You guys remember 9/11? The churches were completely full to capacity right after 9/11. Do you know why that happened? It's because people were afraid. All of a sudden, for the first time in many people's lives that had never been in war before, and on American soil, they reached us. It scared a lot of people. They couldn't believe, as I couldn't believe, what I was watching on major news. When I saw the Twin Towers coming down, I didn't think it was real at first. But then I knew when it went worldwide, the news, I knew it was real. But yet, in all of that, great numbers come to church, and they took a poll, and the numbers that were attending before 9/11, now they went after 9/11, and the numbers after 9/11, remember that during the 9/11 period, for months, the churches were full to capacity, record attendance. But then just months after 9/11, the attendance was less than the attendance before 9/11. So just think on that for a minute, just ponder that. I'm not going to be there in that group. I want to say Jesus is coming back anytime, and I want to be ready for him. Amen. And I want to be focused on what is happening. And I believe in prayer. And I don't think that it's hopeless right now. I think that many people are going to be saved before it's over. Don't you wish everything could be fixed? Crime, war, families torn apart, hate, and all of the brokenness all around us. But in the midst of all this, Jesus is praying for us. I want to give you a little insight before I get into the scriptures of Romans chapter 8, verses 33 on. And this is what Paul said, because I want you to think about what I just talked to you briefly, just before we started all this. In 2 Thessalonians 2:7, we don't have it on the screen, but I want to give you a little insight of what Paul said. He said, as for their work, this man of rebellion and hell will do when he comes. This is what he's doing. It says, it is already going on. But he himself will not come until the one who is holding him back steps out of the way. So do you understand what I'm saying? That what we're seeing right now is we're seeing everything falling apart all around us. The families disintegrated, the nuclear family, meaning husband and wife, married, kids, all of that, the American dream. It's almost as though we had in our hands the baby boomers after the war, and now it doesn't matter how hard you try to hang on to it, it just kind of, have you ever picked up sand and you moved your finger? It starts to just fall through your fingers. So we're losing all of that. Our cities are broken all across the United States. So Paul's giving us a little insight here. He's saying, look, you guys, this man of rebellion that's known as the Antichrist, this man and all of hell backing him, he's being held back from totally destroying us, from totally annihilating us. And Paul's giving us insight. He said, and tell the one that's holding him back. We don't know. Scholars and theologians right now don't exactly know who that is that's holding him back. But don't you thank God that he's being held back right now, that we can get some work done before Jesus comes? I happen to have friends that I want to see come into the household of God. How about you?
Yes.
I'm thankful that the one that's holding him back, so it could be the Holy Spirit, which we know that he's holding him back. It could be the government. It could be all of that we have. We have military. We have all of that that keeps us safe. And so it could be a combination of all those things that's holding him back. What do you think would happen if all of a sudden God stepped out of the way and the Spirit of the living God just moved out of the way and said, Antichrist, go ahead, take that man that you're going to fill. That man, the Antichrist, is going to be filled with Satan himself. A man, just like you or I, a woman, is going to be actually, can you imagine that? That he will all of a sudden be completely filled by Satan himself. And he'll be the man of rebellion. But what Paul is saying is that he's not going to come yet. He's already at work. And I see him at work. How about you? Did you turn on the news last night? I see him at work. I see people getting murdered, getting stabbed, getting shot, being kidnapped. I see him at work right now, but he's being held back. And in all this, we as Christians are constantly being accused. If you watch the news like I do, you can see that Christians, by many circles, they're hated. All you have to do is bring up Jesus and you immediately find a whole bunch of haters. And they think that you are, yeah, they have a lot of words for us. But they just haven't seen the light yet. But we know that before it's all over, a lot of them that are haters and that are accusing us, the brethren, we're Christians, and so they're accusing us. And if we're not careful, then we're going to begin to believe that ourselves. And so we have to be so careful, because Paul said that in the last days, he said that if it were possible, even the very elect would be deceived. So that's why we meet together. People say, why is church so important? It's not legalistic. It's because if we don't get together, the most powerful entity on earth is church. Did you know that? And because Jesus is the head of the church, and he empowers the church by his Spirit. So God himself in all of heaven backs this place right now. All of you that are in here, God and all of heaven and all the angels, they back us. They back what we're doing here. So people say, I don't need to go to church. Church isn't important. Church is going to become more and more important as the days go on. Because if we don't get together as a community, and we're going to be speaking about this over the next several weeks, if we don't learn to love each other, and if we don't become united in this, what do you think is going to happen? When all hell, I feel like all hell's already broken loose, but it's going to get a whole lot worse, the Bible tells us, before it's over. So we need each other, we need to stick together, we need to learn what it is to love each other, and we need to learn what does it mean to be community in a church. I know what community is. I saw what man has built. Let's just take San Bernardino. San Bernardino, the city of San Bernardino, it's community. It is a community, but it's not community.
No, we're not.
I happen to be on a group that is, I myself am the community engagement guy for San Bernardino, for the city. So they voted me in, so they must have thought I could help or do something. So I said, God, I'll go ahead. So here's what I get to do. I get to be with all the other people that know things that none of us would know. I get to hear about crisis engagement. I get to hear about the kidnapping that just took place just recently, right over here, a few blocks from here. I get to hear about the prostitution. I get to hear about the violence that never makes the news. I get to hear about what's going on inside the school classrooms in grade school and junior high, and they give me reports every month, twice a month. And I get to sit with the board members of the entire 33 school districts, of the ones that oversee and govern, and I get to hear the uncut version of what's going on. And I sit back, and it doesn't surprise me, and I say, yes, the man of perdition, the man of rebellion, he is hard at work to kill us and destroy us and to take us out. So now you ask, why is the church so important? Why is the church important for us all to get together, to worship together, as though we are in an image in your mind, think we're all holding hands together and we're worshiping the one true God together, and we're saying Jesus is coming back again. He's the one that we owe our allegiance to. He's our master. He's our savior. It doesn't matter what it looks like. It doesn't matter what they say about us. They can accuse us all they want, but Jesus, he already said, not guilty. Not guilty. So we can either get more excited about where we are right now, about everything that's coming. You can hear it coming down the railroad tracks. You can hear the rumble. It's almost as though it's just right there and it's on its way. And we as Christians know the end of the story. We know exactly what we're headed for. We know what is going on right now. We know what God is doing. So evil is at work right now. It's at work right now. I want to tell you, because we're going to talk right now about prayer. Did you know that prayer is something in John chapter 17? And that really is the Lord's Prayer, you know. I know our Father which art in heaven. I don't want to confuse you. But this is the prayer that Jesus prayed in John chapter 17. He prayed it for his disciples. You know what he prayed? Here's what's interesting. When he prayed for his disciples, he said, Father, I'm not asking you to take them out of this world. I don't want you to remove them. I just poured into them for over 3 years, and I want them to stay here because they have a mission. What I'm asking for, Father, is that you will protect them, that you'll keep them from evil, and that you will give them empowerment to be able to change the world. Yes. And so as he was praying this, he gets to the end of John 17, and we're going to deal with that later, Lord willing, over the weeks. He goes into that when he's praying, he prays for the disciples, and now he says, I'm praying for all those that will believe in the message that they preach. So if you were to raise your hand right now, you are those people. You are the future people that Jesus was praying for, that we would not be taken out of the world, that we would be left in the world, because we're not of this world. How many remember that? N-O-T, remember that? Not of this world. Everybody's going around saying, not of this world. Well, you know, it's true. We live here, but we are not a part of this system. We have to live in the system, but we are not a part of this system. Our actual inheritance, when we die, we don't inherit anything here on earth. You know what we inherit? We inherit forever with God for eternity. We inherit something that is not perishable, because everything here, we talk about it all the time, it's perishing. I get phone calls constantly. I just had one of my good pastor friends of two churches locally here that just went in for a simple angiogram, and then they rushed her right to the hospital, and the next morning she has to have open heart surgery. Listen, guys, in case you didn't know it, we are all perishing here on earth. If you buy something from the grocery store, what does it say? Refrigerate this, perishable. Even if you freeze it, it still will perish. Everything is going to perish. But Jesus said, you know what he said. He said, but for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, whoever believes on him will not perish, but have everlasting life. So that's the hope that we have. So church is important, guys. And so we need to invite our families. We need to invite our friends. Because what's coming down the tracks is not going to be good. If you don't know Jesus and your hope isn't in him, you could end up having high blood pressure. You could end up as the... It says that in the end, James says that the waves are going to toss. It's going to be such a calamity that men's hearts are actually going to fail them. You know, men are going to be having heart attacks because of the fear. And I just thought of this, that, you know, there have been earthquakes. And did you know that there have been men that have been rushed to the hospital and they've died from heart attacks because of an earthquake? Not because anything fell on them, but because when the ground starts shaking underneath them, then they began to have so much fear and anxiety that it actually caused them to have a heart attack. Did you guys know that? So that's what's going to happen. Things are going to get so rough, but we as Christians don't have to worry about that. Why? Because Jesus is praying for us. Jesus is in heaven right now. You're going to see the scriptures that we read today. He is praying for us right now. Just think about that. As you're sitting there right now, everything that you're going through, I want you just to, in your mind, just, that's amazing.
Amen.
Jesus, the author and the finisher of my faith, he's seated at the right hand of honor, the Father, God, that actually spoke everything into existence, and he's sitting there with the Father, and the Father has said, I've given him, Jesus, all the authority in heaven, on earth, and under the earth, all of hell and all the demons. I gave authority to Jesus, and I've made Jesus a head over the church, and he's praying for me. He's praying for you. Now, does he get tired? I don't know about you guys, but sometimes I pray and I get tired. How many of you have ever prayed so long that you're like, I'm not able to focus and concentrate? I'm now so tired that my mind is wandering. I'm thinking about something else besides prayer because I can't focus. I'm tired. Did you know that Jesus never gets tired?
That's right.
Did you know that he never wears out? He never gets lonely. He never is fatigued. He never runs out of power. He has all power. He has all glory. He has everything that's been given to him by the Father. And he's praying for us right now. So if you are one of these people that feels like you have been just accused so much, I want you to follow just for a minute. We're going to take a few minutes here, and we're going to talk about prayer. Did you ever see the billboards they used to have? I still see them every so often. Prayer changes things.
Yeah.
Everybody ever seen that before?
Yeah.
Prayer works. Well, before I read this, I want to tell you a little story about, how many of you know who Reinhard Bonnke is? He is an evangelist born in Germany. He had a vision. He had blood-washed Africa all the way from the north to the south. He believed that God had called him, perhaps, one of the only men in the world to have the... He had up to 1.5 million people at one time in one crusade. Can you imagine 40 acres, 1.5 million people come to hear the gospel message of Jesus Christ? So in the early days, he would go, as he's setting up things as a missionary to Africa, he was in a little village, and he was there going village to village, and he was gathering together people and doing what a missionary does. Well, he didn't think about it. He was very thirsty. It was hot, as it is in Africa. It's hot. And so he went, and he drew water from this place that was on the property of where he was staying, and he drank the water because he was very thirsty. By nightfall, he had developed a fever that was so high that it could cause you to have seizures. It's a remarkable story. So he's laying on his deathbed for many hours. He's not getting better. So there's a woman that had supported him for many years, and she's thousands of miles away. And she's in Germany. He's in Africa. And she has, in the middle of the night, she has this unction come on her. Reinhard's in trouble. Doesn't know anything about what's going on. This is a long time ago. They didn't have the internet. They didn't have cell phones that you can call the other parts of the world. But you know, Jesus isn't limited by that. Holy Spirit, not limited by technology. So she begins to pray. She prays all the way through the night. The prayer is so urgent that God has put on her, she doesn't stop praying. And then the sun comes up in the morning, and she feels the burden lift on her, off of her. And then she finds out sometime later, months later, the date perfectly lined up with when she had this burden to pray for him. It was the exact night that he was laying there on his deathbed. And when the fever lifted on him and he felt great the next morning, got up and started back to work again, then the burden lifted off of her. Tell me that prayer doesn't work. Tell me that prayer doesn't change things. Prayer is amazing. So if you're praying for somebody, don't quit. I'm sure thankful that people didn't quit praying for me. I'm sure they thought a few times it's not working. Probably people in your family thought the same thing about you. It's not working, so let's not pray anymore. It's impossible. With God, all things are possible. Say that with me out loud. With God, all things are possible. So when we come upon Romans, we see that the Apostle Paul, he writes this in chapter 8, verse 33. I'm going to read to you out of the New Living Translation. Who dares accuse us whom God has chosen for his own? No one. For God himself has given us right standing with himself. How did that happen? You see that cross right there?
Yeah, come on.
That's what gave us right standing. Jesus stood between us and God. He was the mediator, and He made it possible for you and I to be in this place right now. When we pray in the mornings, Karen and I, many times, you know what our first thankfulness is? Thank you, God, for our salvation. Amen. Thank you, God, for our salvation. Not only what Jesus did on the cross, but He got through. I don't know about you, but when I was younger, I had a hard head. When I was younger, I didn't believe like everybody was telling me I was supposed to believe. And you know why I didn't believe it fully? You can tell by my actions. I was out doing things that were totally against God. And that's how I knew that I didn't believe fully. But I thank God today that He got to me. How many did He get to? How many did He come to you? And that by the power of the Holy Spirit, He changed your entire outlook on everything forever. You will never go back to the way that you live. You will never do what you used to do. And is it because you're good? No, it's not because you're good. It's because now God lives inside of you, and His blood has washed you as white as snow. And now when the Father looks at you, that's why Paul can say this. It says God has chosen you for His own. No one. For God Himself has given us right standing with Himself. And then verse 34, He even strengthens it and emboldens it. Who then will condemn us? No one. For Christ Jesus died for us and was raised to life for us, and He is sitting at the right place of honor at God's right hand, pleading for us.
Amen.
He's praying for us right now.
Amen.
Church, every one of you, me, all of us, He's praying for the millions of people. They're saying, I told you last week, 2.5 billion Christians on earth. That's how powerful Jesus is. My prayer list is pretty small compared to that. How big's your prayer list compared to, and He knows every one of us. Did you know He knows the number of hairs on your head?
Yep.
For me, it's a little easier to count because as we get older, but some of us, He knows the day that you were born. He knows when you were conceived, before you were going to be conceived. He knows when you're going to die. He knows your whole life, everything about your life. And He is right now sitting at the place of honor, the right hand of God, and He's praying for us. There's no time in heaven. So it's not even 24/7. He will never quit until we're out of here. And once we're out of here, there'll be no more need for prayer, will there? Because we're going to be with Jesus and with God. It says that there'll be no need for lights anymore. No Southern California Edison. No Southern California gas. No utilities. It says you'll need no sun. Right now, our sun is literally deteriorating. They don't know how long it'll last. But we won't even need the sun anymore to give us daylight. Because it says God and Jesus will be walking the streets, and there'll be the light, so we won't even need any light. Can you guys imagine the picture of the hope that we have to be with God and Jesus forever and ever? And now, in the interim period, He's praying for us. He's praying that we'll complete our mission. He's praying for safety. I say this all the time. How many feel like you shouldn't even be here right now? You should be dead. I don't know how, except for by a miracle from God that I survived. Some of the close calls. It's a miracle. It's a miracle. I remember one time that my brother and me, we were on our motorcycles. They went very fast. They were high performance. We're out on a country road. And we were coming around a blind turn. We were both doing, I don't want to say it faster. Well, yeah, I did. I did bad things. I don't speed anymore, okay? But we were doing 100 plus. And he was in the oncoming traffic, and I was in this lane, and we came around a blind turn, and motorcycles at that speed, in case you didn't know, especially the suspension that they had back in those days, nothing like today, they don't handle real well at 100 miles. And all of a sudden, there was a full-size car right there. And I saw my brother lean the bike as hard as he could. I leaned my bike so he wouldn't collide with me. And I literally, I thought I saw him. You know, you wear bell bottoms back in the 70s?
Oh, yeah.
I literally think I saw his bell bottom hit the bumper in the front of that car. I have never forgot that as long as I've lived. You know why? Because that's how quick he could have been gone. But yet God, through, I believe, the prayers of my mother. My mother was a prayer warrior.
Yes.
You could be in the house and you'd hear her back in the bedroom. You'd hear her wailing and praying, calling out names. And I was like, listen, I said, what are you doing, Mom? Now I get it.
Yes, sir.
She had a burden for us. She had a burden for all of her cousins and aunts and uncles and neighborhood people. She had a burden and she was, God had placed that on her and she was a prayer warrior. How many ever heard of a prayer warrior?
Yeah.
Well, I believe that my mom was praying for my brother and that's why he didn't die instantly. There'd been nothing left of him. He'd have been killed instantly. So how many of you, I'm going to ask you the question again. How many, you don't know how you got here today, but you are here today. So that means that God has a purpose for you. There's a reason why that you are here. It's not by accident.
Come on, say it.
It's not because of the rabbit's foot you carry around in your pocket. It's not by luck that you are here. It's because God's designed for you and He died for you. He has a mission for you. And don't get caught up in all of the stuff that's going on and get fearful. And don't even get caught up in the busyness of life, because Jesus said, even if you're caught up in that, He's still coming back.
Oh, yeah.
He's going to come back so quickly. It's what I want to get across. If I can teach any of you anything, please live like He's going to come back any moment. Because He can come back in the middle. But don't worry, because if you're not thinking about Him, it doesn't mean you're going to be left behind.
Right.
So as you go on, and it says He's sitting in place of honor at the God's right hand pleading for us. So did you ever think, any time in your life, I have, did you ever think because you weren't good enough for God, He will not save you? It's the honest thing that happens to us. I feel like that sometimes, because you can't earn your way.
That's right.
Do you ever feel as if salvation is for everyone else but you? Well, then these verses are especially for you.
Yes.
If God gave His Son for you and I, He isn't going to hold back the gift of salvation.
Right.
He will not hold it back. If Christ gave His life for you, He isn't going to turn around and condemn you. Even though the people that are accusing us because we are Christ followers and they're condemning us, Christ will not condemn you.
That's right.
And He will not hold back anything that you need to live for Him. Understand that today. Anything that you and I are going to need to live for Him throughout today and today on until He comes back or until you die, He's going to give you everything you need.
Amen.
So whatever you need, say, I don't worry about it.
That's right, Pastor.
God's going to give it to me. Whatever I've got to overcome, He already overcame it. If I've got this stronghold on my mind, I'm going to keep washing it with the Word of God. How many of you have ever had something, you worked in some clothes or got a stain, you had to wash it 5 times to get the stain out? Well, that's the way I'm doing my brain. Some of this stuff, I can't get out of there real quick, so you know what I do? I wash it with the Word of God. I read it until I get it so deep in me that it becomes louder than the accusations that the devil's making. Because the devil's constantly accusing me. Look at you. You do that. You don't do that enough. And I keep washing my mind so that I renew it to the point where now it becomes so loud that now when he accuses me, I don't hear his voice as loud as I used to. And his voice becomes more and more faint. Is anybody getting that today? It will become fainter and fainter until, I'm not being disrespectful to the enemy, but I don't hear you anymore.
That's right, Pastor.
I'm hearing my master more. He's much louder than what I'm hearing you say. You can accuse me all you want, but God said that I'm his. He bought me, and he's declaring that I'm his own. And if I'm his own, then I don't belong to you. I don't have to listen to you.
That's true.
I'm only going to listen to what the Father says about me. Because he says that I am as white as snow. He says that I am good. And you know, when you look at things, it feels like it's getting darker and darker in our communities across America, doesn't it? But Paul is saying here that Jesus is interceding for us in heaven. And God has acquitted us and has removed our sin and guilt. So it is Satan, not God, who accuses us. And an advocate is someone who supports us. Did you know that Jesus is our advocate?
Yes.
And if he's sitting at the right hand of the Father, the place of honor, and if he's praying and interceding and pleading for me, he's my advocate. That means that he supports me. Amen. Think about that today as you're sitting there, that he's supporting you. And when he does, Jesus, the advocate for our defense, he stands at God's right hand to present our case. Amen. How many of you got a case? I got a whole bunch of cases. But interceding, it's a verb, it's an action to intervene between parties. So the NASB, that version, it uses intercedes. Now I want you to understand, Paul, he had a court of law in mind here as he was writing this. No charge can be brought against the Christian because why? God has already pronounced you not guilty. In a court of law and you got the whole jury there and you know that they're getting ready to pronounce sentence upon you and you say, I'm not worried about it. I'm not worried because I knew coming in here, now this is now talking biblically, theologically, God's already acquitted me. Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God. And I'm not guilty. I don't know if that's freeing for you, but that's freeing for me and it gives me a different perspective so that I can be a little stronger in what I do. Is that he has already acquitted me. And then he goes on, Romans 8:35, you see that this begins to build and build. He says in verse 35, can anything ever separate us from Christ's love? Does it mean he no longer loves us if we have trouble or calamity or are persecuted or hungry or destitute or in danger or threatened with death? Many of you have had your friends and your family, they've abandoned you. I know that, what that feels like. It seems like that over money, when you get in trouble, you know, everything was great, but then as soon as you get in trouble with anything, and they have their perspective about you, it's like, bye.
Yeah.
Not only friends, but family. And I thought about this, how many of you remember a song that it came out in 1971? Nobody's going to probably remember this group. It was released in 71. It's the Undisputed Truth. Anybody remember that? I bet when I say these lyrics to you, a couple of them, you're going to remember. And they were actually given an award in 1972. Listen to this. The name of it was Smiling Faces. Remember that?
Yeah.
Say? You might not know Undisputed Truth, but that was the name of the group. Well, this is just to a couple of lyrics. I was thinking about this. As I was thinking about people and about friends and how much they've let me down and how when I look at these scriptures, it just builds me up and I have so much confidence. Smiling faces sometimes pretend to be your friends. Mm. Remember, a smile is just a frown turned upside down, my friend. Beware of a handshake. Hey, your enemy won't do you no harm because you know where he's coming from. So when you look at things on a human perspective and you look at the world and you look at love and you look at even our families, you can see that this is really something that's encouraging, that what can separate you from the love of God? What? Calamity? Trouble? All of these things, nothing can separate you from the love of God, where I feel like sometimes, and it was out of my control, that I got separated from my friends because of something that happened. Sometimes I felt like it was out of my control. But it happened, and now people that you thought were your really good friends, they were smiling all the time until all of a sudden something happened and it changed their perspective towards you. And how many, you know, have you ever heard the word snub?
Yeah.
I have walked into places that things beyond my control happened, and they looked at me and snubbed me. You know what it feels like to be snubbed?
Yeah.
To walk up to somebody and say, hi, how are you doing? And they're just like this. Mm. Okay, I guess they don't want to talk to me. So then you go, and then you feel like the whole room. You're starting to look around, you think, man, everybody snubbed me. What do I do? I don't have any friends left in the world. But God says, I will never leave you. What can separate you from the love of God? I like Paul's list. Pretty much goes through anything that we would ever go through. He said, even to the point, he goes, the last one he says is death. Not even death can separate you from the love of God. So when you die, he loves you so much, he's just waiting for you, because to be absent from the body, this tent right here, guess what it means for you when you know Jesus? To be absent from this is to be present with the Lord. Now, I would much rather be present with the Lord than present with a lot of people that I know. I know that sounds terrible. Well, people, you can't depend on everybody. You can't really know what's going to happen from month to month. You know, you could have your best friends turn on you in a moment. Jesus is your best friend, and he will never turn on you. Nothing you could ever do would cause Jesus to ever leave you or forsake you. So, when you read this, it's as though Paul wanted his readers to be comforted beyond anything they could imagine. He wants you and I to be so comforted and so secure that it could be beyond anything we could ever even imagine. Because believers have always had to face hardships in many forms. Persecution, illness, imprisonment, and even death. These things could make you feel like you have been abandoned by Christ. I know I talk to people quite often. I get calls from different jails, Washington, D.C., from back east, from local, from Los Angeles. And I really feel for some of these men because they feel like they've been abandoned. They feel like that their families abandoned them. They can't get anybody to put money on their books. They call them, and they say they won't answer the phone. They try to call collect. I don't know if any of you understand what I'm saying, but you can get to a point where you feel abandoned. But Paul is clearly saying here, God will never abandon you. He will never leave you. There's nothing that can separate you from the love of God. And all of these things. He explains that it is impossible to be separated from Christ. His death for us is proof of his unconquerable. There's nothing that can conquer this love. If he died on that cross for you, and God raised him from the dead, what can conquer that? And that God is living right now, and he's on planet Earth, and he's in your life, and he's in my life. So in verse 37, here's what Paul says. No, despite these things, overwhelmingly victory is ours through Christ who loved us. And you can't give God a clap for that. That despite all these things, I like this word, overwhelmingly. How many have ever been overwhelmed? I like to be overwhelmed, but not by bad things. I like to be overwhelmed by the love of God. I like to be overwhelmed by the love of people that love God. So he's saying, overwhelmingly, we have victory. There's nothing that can take us out. So who loved us in this at the end of that? This refers especially to Christ's death on the cross. That if he would do that for me, if he would do that for you and for me. And then in 38, Paul's convinced. Romans 8:38. He says, for I am convinced that nothing can ever separate us from God's love. Do you see how many times love has been in this? Do you see how many times separate is in this? Do you see how many times that Paul wants to make sure and sure and sure that we get it and that we now have such confidence in God? He's going to great lengths here talking to these people and this letter that was distributed, and now we get to read the same letter. And so he goes on, he says, neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither our fears for today nor our worries about tomorrow, not even the powers of hell can separate us from God's love. Amen. Are you getting that this morning, guys? We could jump up and down and dance for about a week straight. There's nothing that can separate us from God's love. Is there anything? Hell, the demons, all of these things, nothing can separate you from the love of God. And then I close with this scripture, Romans 8:39. How fitting it is for Paul to talk this way to us. He says, verse 39, New Living Translation, no power in the sky above or the earth below, indeed, nothing in all creation will ever be able to separate us from the love of God that is revealed in Christ Jesus.
Amen.
Our Lord.
Amen.
You think Paul is wanting us to do this? How many times he tells us? So I'm praying today that as you leave here, and I've been praying that already that you walk in this, that you know with everything you're going through, with everything all around us that's happening, that you know that God is on the throne.
Amen.
And you know that Jesus is sitting at the right hand of the Father, a place of honor. And that he's praying for you. He's praying for Janet. He's praying for Tina. He's praying for Frank. He's praying for Joe. He's praying for Arlene. He's praying for Biden. He's praying for Moses. He's praying for LaDonna. He's praying. He's praying for Gary. He's praying for Tony. He's praying for Carmen. You guys get him, and he's up there right now. And he's praying for you. Now, if the prayer of a righteous man in James chapter 5 availeth much, means it has a lot of power. And then it goes on to say, James writes, he's the leader of the church. He was Jesus' brother. Did you know that? And he wrote the book of James. And so if he says that the prayer of a righteous man has a lot of power, and then he goes on to explain that Elijah was a man just like us. He wasn't God. He wasn't divine. He was a man. And if it says that he prayed that it wouldn't rain, and it didn't rain, and then he prayed that it would rain, and it did rain, it says that we on earth as humans have that kind of power by praying for something. Now I want you to consider this. This is the last thought. If Elijah, and that was given to us as the prayer of a righteous man or a righteous woman availeth much, then if that is fact, which it is fact, and he was a man just like us, how powerful is the prayer of Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God? So if he prayed something over you, if he's praying for this to happen, if there's a mission, if there's something that God has given you specific to your life that he wants you to accomplish while you're here on earth, do you think anything can stop it?
No.
Nothing can stop it. You will finish what God designed you to do. But now, if you put yourself out there, and we might touch on this in weeks to come, if you get away from God, things can happen. I'm not trying to put fear into you, but things can happen. You get off track. I tell you, I want to stay focused. I want to be like Paul, where I'm running a race. I'm like an athlete. I'm going to beat myself into submission, my flesh, so that I can run the course and I can finish the race. How many want to finish the race in this place? I want to finish the race. I want to do everything that God wants me to do while I'm here. And I know I think I have a whole lot of other people. Now, we have a lot of people around us that know nothing about what we just talked about.
Yeah.
There are people all through the city. You should come sit with me and sit with all these pastors and with these leaders of the city, and you should hear the uncut version. A lot of these people know nothing about what we know. Nothing. And I believe that I just spoke to a lot of people that by the Spirit of God, you didn't understand it just intellectually. I believe that you received it with your heart. I know that it's something that's not of this world. It is something that's way beyond this. So I'm so thankful to be amongst people who are not alone, that believe in Jesus.
Amen.
Father, I thank you for today. I thank you that there is absolutely nothing that can separate us from the love of God. And that it was revealed through Christ Jesus, the Son of the living God, who is our Savior and our Master. And Father, I pray in these days to come that we will have a revival throughout these cities unlike anything the world has ever known, because the time is getting short. And I pray, God, that we will be able to not be ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ. I pray, God, we'll be able to stand up and we'll be able to give a word, God, that it'll be in us. And then all those people around us that we see every day, every week, that we'll have a word for them of encouragement that will be from you, Father, because you will give us the words to speak when the time comes. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Everyone in this place said?
Amen.
Amen. Give God a clap.